seen the released
art
for the cover of Blood and Wine?
Wait a minute.
Why is it saying off? What do you mean offline? It's not currently offline.
Oh, there's a thing. I saw a thing.
There's a thing.
I saw a thing. I've just refreshed, but literally just as I clicked refresh, I saw a thing. Yes, we're live. We're live.
Oh God! Finally. We're actually live. Okay, I'm tweeting it out.
I don't see your channel in the following channel list.
Shut up. No, I think we might be live.
Yes, we are officially.
Finally, stream configuration quality excellent. It's saying everything again.
There we go. Chat.
It only took just freaking hours and nonsense.
Blood sacrifices and acts with the dark gods.
I have this Pavlovian thing now. I see you do that. I want to go, Hathor, hey! Even though every time Vayner just goes, actually, it's Huthor. You've been saying it wrong all along.
I've been going by that name for, oh God, probably 10 years at this point. It was the very first World of Warcraft character I ever made. And everyone and their mother has pronounced it wrong for the entirety of that time. So at this point, I just, whatever.
I don't know. Just the amount. I mean, Huthor actually makes sense.
Audio's gone to crap
and
again.
And this goes. I think that's roll 20. I actually don't think that's your problem. I think that's
let's switch to Hangouts. At least we'll have like better audio and full screen stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is just a super professional stream.
Mm-hmm. Don't worry about it.
Okay. In that case, I'm going to make sure to open a different window and get to the Hangout.
I'll disable my stuff here. At least we could use Roll20 times.
Wow, yeah. Your audio is also going screwy. Wait a minute, it says it's the same thing. That's weird. So how do you want to do this? You start something and you invite us or what?
Right, let me send you the link. I think William is already there.
Okay. If it's the same one, then yeah, I should be.
Oh, that is the same one. Okay, then in that case, I'll close this one.
Yeah, just use that for the audio.
There we go. All right, cool.
Okay, there we go.
I'll turn myself off in Roll 20. There we go.
Perfect. Okay, we are in here. Dungeon World, Jex is 1985, DMing a new game. Perfect. And Chacha Shakalaka is joining in.
Hello.
Okay, I'm going to need to... Wait, why is it not... Oh, wait, I need to join the old one, right? To get that thing on.
Yeah, yep, you do.
How do you do that again? Original version?
Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pop out the chat so that I can
see my face on the other screen.
Keep up with my modding duties.
So how are you doing this? You're doing real name and then marketing.
Where the hell did it go?
Subtitle. There we go.
Aha. Uh-huh. Cool, so then I can...
Adequate naming, right?
Yeah.
Oh god, I'm gonna have to be professional. What's this?
Fub. Hey, fub, do you want to join in?
Adam!
Oh yeah, I'm getting him right away. I'm like, just get in here. Get over here.
Get in here.
There we go.
There we go. Perfect. I have this giant just Jex's face just.
Yes. It's a bit daunting, isn't it? Wait, let me zoom out a bit because I'm zoomed in all the way up to my nostrils.
This is good, because then in the tiny screen there, you have a little bit more, a face. That's why I'm fully zoomed in.
Okay.
So that everyone can enjoy the train wreck just right there.
Fine!
Okay, perfect. So maybe just give a second to see if Fub is interested. And then I think, well, we should be ready to go, right? Hold on, you have the character sheets, right?
I do.
Yeah, you're going to need to fight amongst yourselves for a bit, because I think both of you want to play a cleric.
Yes, I did, yes.
No, I am absolutely fine with both of you playing clerics. That's doesn't matter to me.
See, now, this, the inner DM in me says that it would be very interesting if perhaps we had two different gods that we have to sort of conflict over how we should proceed. Like, you have the god of, you know, conquest and bloodthirstiness, and I'm like the peaceful, loving god or something along those lines. I don't know.
In all fairness, it was, you know, I was talking about it with Jexus earlier. I saw the Slayer, and I was like, that is a Witcher. Probably he's going to want to play a Witcher.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I've done that. I've been there, got the t-shirt when it comes to, like, fighter-type classes. I've never actually played a healer, so...
Okay, how do we do this again? We need to open this in Chrome, I think, for it to be forum fillable. Vaynin, you are absolutely on time.
Train wreck incoming.
Oh, yes. Let me see where I'm going to put this.
Well, I think train wreck probably in progress.
Yeah.
Right. I've got the chat popped out.
There we go. What am I going to put the hangout here? I'm going to need the chat.
I'm going to pop this out again.
Wait, not on stream, buddy. I want to keep on streaming.
Is it?
There we go.
Okay. Okay. Am I too loud, guys?
No, you're fine. You're fine. Absolutely.
You're fine for me, but Paolo's audio could be a bit louder.
Could be louder. Yeah. Okay. In that case, I can just improve it like this.
Yeah. And well, Vaynin says I'm a little loud, so what I'm going to do is I'll actually.
Sergnum, hey there. Sora, good to see you as well. Hotos was a little bit louder than Burrox. Okay, so yeah, we fixed that right now.
I will.
So, yeah. Anybody want to join in? Fub, Sergnum.
Just do what I do and say Fub3x. Sounds a lot cooler.
It does.
Fub3x, yeah.
He doesn't know the system. That's fine.
No worries. Okay. Let's see. Yeah, so the question is, you want to play a cleric? That's fine. I mean, on the one hand, I always love playing a wizard, but I also play a wizard in Jexus's other game already, so that'd be a bit boring.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, can I be a comedy bard? A bard that doesn't sing, but just tells stand-up comedian bard.
Yeah, you can. It's it doesn't matter, as long as you perform.
Yeah, and then you could, like, blaspheme every 5 seconds, and I get really upset with you.
Perfect. Fub joining in. Okay, Vaynin wants my voice to be a little bit louder still. I can boost this a little bit. Let's see. Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Vaynin, how am I? Am I still loud for you guys?
Paolo, could you send the Hangout URL to Fub? Because I've got the chat popped out. I'm not sure if it...
Sure thing. Let me whisper Fub.
Hey there, Ghost.
Every time you say it, it's like Fub.
That's what it is in my head. It's like dubstep.
Awesome. Cool.
That wasn't what I was thinking of, but okay. Oh yeah, Ghost William is
tis me, Huthor.
Huthor.
You're mispronouncing it. It's Hothor.
Hootus?
No, it's Huthor.
Oh.
Oh, that's even worse.
Oh, hey, is that a fub? That is a fub.
A why? It's a wild one and he appears.
At least the stream is super effective. Okay, I'm going to turn on the lights.
The professional qualities of the stream are amazing.
Ah.
Okay, I think we are all ready.
The 3x fub has entered.
Can you guys hear me okay?
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah. Sure, absolutely. Let's see, where are we? Wait, what's the Hangout toolbox? What?
Really
something
cool.
Oh god, JP's just gone live with D&D. Time to compete, boys.
That was our audience.
That was exactly our audience. Okay. There we go. Perfect. Let's see. Hoot whore? Yeah, that does sound worse. Okay. Okay. I can see Fub has lots of experience.
I run a weekly game of the One Ring through Hangouts. So.
Ah, perfect.
It's got all the overlays.
Let me.
I got all the overlays.
A link to the form fillable PDF character sheets, and then we can get going.
Awesome! Awesome.
And then I can do an introduction for you guys as to what the game actually is, and for the people watching, because otherwise it'll be really confusing. Let's see. There's a chat thing here somewhere. There we go. I posted the link in the chat.
Are we using the... you are using that, yeah. So are we using that in general as well, or are we just sticking to the dice stream thing?
Well, you use the dice stream to roll dice, and don't think we need chat open.
Probably not.
For most of it, so...
That's a way of saying screw it to roll 20, then.
Yeah.
Cool. That's good. That frees up a monitor.
If dice stream doesn't work for you, William, then just shout out the dice you rolled, and that'll be fine.
Well, there we go. I've just rolled some dice. Does anything happen? No.
Don't see it. No.
No. Okay. Well, I'm. Wait.
I think I had this. Did you switch to the old version of the Hangouts?
I did. Yes.
Well, there goes my complete knowledge about the subject.
at least I think I did. Let me.
Yeah, just to make it, you know, sensible as well, I can't do the whole Twitch streamer thing right now, so I'm just going to type it in chat, and I'm assuming, you know, Jack says that you'll take over when you have the thing.
Yeah, if everyone has the character sheets in front of them, then we can get started. Dungeon World is a hack of Apocalypse World, and that probably doesn't mean much to many people, but basically it's a role-playing game where the GM and the players together create the world, create the setting, think of names for stuff. I'll be mostly asking questions to you guys, and you'll provide me with an improvised answer, basically. And when you ask me a question, and I don't really have an answer to that, or I don't particularly care what the answer is, then I'll just ask you to give the answer yourself. Dungeon World is the basically the Dungeons & Dragons version of Apocalypse World, and then simplified. What it is you'll be describing your actions, and I'll be saying what you need to roll to make that happen. And in the PDF that I sent, let me post that link in the chat as well. If people want to read along and whatever, they can do that. There's a list of basic moves that you can make. And a move is basically the equivalent of an action in D&D. So you've got hack and slash, which basically means that whenever you want to try and hit something or punch someone or stab someone or whatever, you roll hack and slash, which is a roll plus your strength value. If you want to shoot something, then you roll volley, or you do a volley. If you want to get out of the way of danger, or if you want to defy any sort of danger in any way, then you use the defy danger move. If you want to defend one of your fellow party members, then you'll use the defend move. And if you want to have an idea of whether or not you have knowledge about a specific thing, then you can use the spout lore move. And if you want to use the equivalent of perception in D&D, then you discern realities. Any charisma check is usually a parlay, and you can also help or interfere with others. So what does a roll look like? Every roll you make, with the exception of damage rolls, is a 2d6 plus a particular attribute bonus. The way it's distributed is on a 10 plus, basically the thing you propose happens without fault. You want to leap over a chasm? Okay, you roll defy danger, dexterity probably, or strength if you want to use your raw power for jumping. On a 10 plus, you do it marvelously. On a 7 to 9, however, something happens. You stumble, you hesitate, you flinch. Your proposed action works, but there's a drawback. You might lose an item. You might alert monsters in the area. They might be a huge sound, or for instance, if you jump, you might be able to just catch the edge of the cliff or whatever, and you're in even more trouble than you thought you were.
That never happens.
GM shenanigans.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, GM shenanigans. I basically have an entire list of moves that I can make whenever you fuck up.
Byronic dies. Byronic gets a horrible disease. Byronic gets a broken arm.
On a 6 minus, you are in real trouble. You are at my mercy, basically. So that's the basic moves that you have. And then there's some advanced moves that or special moves that are not really, you know, we don't need to discuss them now because they usually happen when you make a long trip or when you camp or whatever. And then we'll just, whenever that happens, we'll look at it, we'll read it, and we'll go through it. Mm-hmm. So you have your character sheets, and there's the basic D&D classes basically. And instead of actions, your character has moves, starting moves. For instance, the bard has the arcane art, and it just says when you weave a performance into a basic spell, choose an ally and an effect. So what does that mean? That just means that whenever you choose to weave a performance into a basic spell, that happens. There's no I cast something or other, and then we'll look up and see what that cast thing does. No, this just means you, I don't know, play your lute or do a bit of a stand-up routine and cheer on one of your fellow party members, and then you can use your arcane art. For instance, bardic lore, when you first encounter an important creature, you get to ask questions about that creature, and we'll just have to make up stuff. So that's basically what you can do with the character. Are there any questions so far?
Nope.
I'm fine.
Nope. Yeah.
All right. Then what we need to do now is decide on who wants to play what character class, with the restriction that there can't be more than one of each class. Now, this mainly applies to the wizard, as far as I'm concerned, because having more than one wizard, not a good idea.
That'd be hilarious, though.
Not a good idea as in underpowered or overpowered?
Underpowered.
Aw.
No, absolutely and utterly underpowered.
Okay. A party full of halfling bards would be hilarious, though.
It would be hilarious, absolutely.
Oh my god, we can play the Three Amigos!
Boy band.
Oh, that'd be amazing.
This is where I sit back and decide on whatever you want to do, and then we'll go through character creation.
Only downside, though, I'm looking at the bard. You can only be a human or an elf.
Can you?
Yeah, that's a race selection, elf and human.
Yeah, all right. Well, that's the restrictions you have. Yeah, if it's on the sheet, that's the only choices you can make.
Yeah. I have my eyes on the thief class.
All right.
Paula, if you really wanted to be a cleric, I would quite be happy to go druid.
I don't really want to be a cleric. I can very much play a bard. That would be fine.
Cool. I shall take the
cleric. Oh, my God. I even have props with me right now.
Oh, wow.
Oh, all right. Go on, give us a taster of what we can expect.
I think it is out of tune, which is perfect for the bard.
Oh, I already feel inspired.
All right. Yeah, so we've got a bard, cleric, and thief?
Yeah.
All right, cool.
Okay, that works.
And then I'm just going to go to through the character creation. I forgot to grab my Dungeon World book because that makes it a bit easier. Just a second.
Seriously, I need to tune this thing because right now it's...
Sounds amazing.
That's all right.
It's wonderful.
It's all right. At the moment, we're at camp. We're doing the Skyrim thing where a guy says, What do you look like? And we're just morphing with hundreds of different faces as we pick our characters.
It's so out of tune. Oh, God.
And you're sitting there strumming your lute.
Lutelele.
Where is it? I can't find it. Preparation is key, right? All right. Choose a class. We've done that.
We are so professional.
So the next thing you do is you choose your race. And for every race, there's a specific benefit to your class.
Wait, for instance, as a bard. We jump straight to race, not even...
Yeah. These sheets are ordered differently from what I from how they're ordered in the book. But okay. just follow along with me and then we'll be fine.
Okay. So we're filling this out, yeah?
Yeah, if you just fill this out. Cool. You don't need to tell me now. We can just do that once we're done.
Okay, cool.
So it's usually a choice between two and three.
Now, there we go. So for me, either an elf, when I enter an important location, I can ask the GM for one fact from the history of the location. But human, let's face it, when you first enter a civilized settlement, someone who respects the custom of hospitality will take you in as their guest.
Yeah, exactly. And then you can use your charming and open skill to ask them, how can I get you to go to bed with me?
I wasn't going to go there, but I mean...
Look, is it going to be a game like that?
No, dear God, no.
If you've chosen your...
20 minutes of awkward role-playing.
Your race, then you can choose a name. You can choose one from the list, or you just make one up yourself. Doesn't matter to me. And then once you have a name, you can choose your look. And you pick one name from the list.
What? Names are always so terrible.
Pick one of each from that list.
Baldrick? Oh my god, Baldrick.
Baldrick is a great name.
Okay,
Baldrick the Bard.
Yeah. Now, if somebody can be the Blackadder...
Hazel, the Halfling Thief?
There was a scene in Blackadder where Baldrick tried to recite poetry. I think it was in Goes Forth.
Let's see if I can actually...
I think it is, yeah.
I remember what it was. He called it The Guns. Boom! Boom! Verse 2, boom, 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 and so on.
There we go, I've got my character sheet up for everyone to see. Okay.
If you've got the name and the look down. Then we can go to the distribution of stats. And I think it says so on the sheets what you can fill in. Distribute those. The one thing you should know is that your HP is determined by your constitution score plus a fixed number, a flat number, and not your constitution bonus. So if your constitution is 16, that means your HP is 16 plus the flat score for your class. And the bard is, I think, 6.
Amazing. Awesome.
I think the thief is as well. Cleric is probably an 8.
Obviously, I am going to be super charismatic. You know, it's a depiction of real life.
Yeah.
Clerics like wisdom, I assume.
It should be wisdom, yeah.
Yeah.
Your spellcasting is a wisdom modifier.
Okay, cool. So that's obviously where my big numbers are going to go. I've got an idea.
There we go. Perfect.
What do the checkboxes, weak, shaky, sick, etc., mean?
That means when we're playing the game, you might become sick. And then you check that box, which means you get a -1 ongoing, as they call it in Dungeon World, which is just a -1 penalty to your die roll for constitution checks.
Okay.
Or anything to do with constitution.
12.
Okay. They just gave them a name for flavor, but it's just any effect that affects that stat, then you just check that box.
Okay, that's cool.
And a minus one is a pretty hefty penalty. If you're rolling with 2d6.
Right. Done, so. Okay.
And once that is done, then you determine your maximum HP, which is your class's base HP. It should say so next to the HP thing. It says your max HP is flat number plus constitution score.
6 plus constitution, so that is 18 for me.
Uh, 19. Awesome.
Right.
Okay.
I think what you could do, Paolo, and what's your real name, Fub, if we...
if you don't mind, we can go
if
by
you don't
Fub,
mind,
Fub.
Yeah. We can also just call you Hazel.
I'm fine with anything.
All right.
So my nickname is Fub, and my character's name is Hazel.
We'll just go by character name now, from now on. But there is a little checkbox in the dice stream called Counter. You can enable that.
Yeah.
And then how about we use that for your HP?
Okay, that works.
And everyone has a clear idea of how hurt you are. Or will be.
Wow, that was the weirdest little no.
No?
What we need here is Mrs. Jexus in the background doing the whole Statler and Waldorf on you.
Terrible! Boo!
If
you have your max HP, then you choose your starting moves, and in general, you just have those, unless one of your moves has you make a choice. I think William, you get to choose your deity and the precept of the religion. And under cast a spell, it says that, or on the commune, it says that you have an X number of spells available, so you can choose those.
Okay.
So where was this?
Starting moves. You don't have to choose anything, I think.
Okay, cool.
And I think the thief has some poison stuff that needs to be picked out.
What kind of god do I want?
No, there are no checkboxes for me select on the...
That's under the gear thing. We'll get to that later.
Okay. I do need to pick an area of expertise, apparently, for my bardic lore.
That is something you need to do, yeah.
I don't have anywhere to note that down, though.
Then you just need to remember.
Memory.
Question. What kind of deity would... like a god of wine and drink and merrymaking come under?
Healing and restoration.
You sure?
No, it depends. You can also go for bloody conquest.
True. Brawling.
Civilization brawling. Also work.
Yeah. No. We'll go healing and restoration. Like, a good pint is reinvigorating.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I would imagine.
I think I'm going to go for the bestiary of creatures unusual.
Nice.
Just so I can go, oh my god, that's a three-toed Lamarckian sloth.
Means that I could get to make up a three-toed Lamarckian sloth. It doesn't look anything.
Yeah, it's just called that.
Yeah. It's just a little frog that goes, hi, I'm Bob.
Yeah.
Let's see.
So... if you've made your choices, or when you've made your choices, you also get to choose your alignment, which is just the checkbox on the top left. There are no restrictions. You can just choose whatever you want. If you want to be evil, you can. And it's an option, then you can. And it's basically a way for you to earn XP at the end of a session if you act out or roleplay your alignment, or the little thing under that alignment, the little phrase. If you've acted that out, or if that happened, then you get to mark XP.
Diffuse a tense situation. Well, that's going to happen.
I'm going to play this like I play Dark Souls games. So I will do the heavy lifting and cheese everything from a distance.
Ah, cheese.
Seems legit.
Sounds like it. So that's definitely an option.
I was just gonna say, I'm gonna play this like I play Dark Souls, frustratingly and just annoying everybody.
And dying every 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Like an emaciated
form. Well, then, no, it depends which one, which Dark Souls. Because one, you just sort of sat behind a wall of metal.
Yeah, but if we play this like Dark Souls 2, Jexus is going to murder us all.
Yes, there's no, there will be no Ballast dancing in this one.
Actually, I'm going to rename my character.
Dual Greatsword Bard.
I'm going to rename my character to Triss.
That's a good one.
I mean, you can. Just, no, you know, no. The Ball wine drink. And drink that I offer you, you might want to, you know, check.
Right, if you, when you pick the alignment, then we go to the next page on your sheet, which says gear. And it says your load is a flat number plus your STR. With that, whenever it's abbreviated, it means that it's your stat bonus and not your stat score.
Okay.
And
so
load just means the amount of stuff you can carry.
Minus one. Hooray!
And then it just gives you a couple of options. Choose between something. And then choose something else, and then choose something else. And if there's items there that you don't understand, then give me a shout, and I'll explain them to you.
Cool.
I like a fiddle never before played. Just, I carry it around. I can't really play it. The pipes with which you first courted your first love. Oh, what? Yeah. Hey, if I choose a stolen horn, can it be a vuvuzela?
Yeah.
Let me play the song of my people.
Goal!
I mean, I can't guarantee that you won't be summoning a bunch of goblins or whatever.
It's the tribe of orcs says, oh, they've summoned us.
Yes, exactly.
Gondor calls for aid!
Ooh, a songbook in a forgotten tongue. That's great.
Right. I'm gonna leave you with the gear for a bit. I'm gonna grab a glass and something to drink. I'll be right back.
Oh, I am not getting any armor. It's ostentation clothes, ostentatious clothes all the way. Oh yes, cheese it from a distance. Worn bow.
Okay.
And here's my major problem. I have the choices between adventuring gear, sounds useful, bandages, sounds very useful, some coins, who could resist coins, or halfling pipe leaf.
Ah, who can resist that?
Exactly, we have to.
Well, as a devoted follower of the god of wine and drink, I think that pipeweed also slides on in there at some point. Giggity.
There we go. Are we okay. Just about done?
I have my gear.
Right.
Healing potion. I have my magic for healing.
Potions.
These are too strong for you, traveler.
I don't require your potions.
So if any of you has like the item bag of books or adventuring gear, that basically
I have adventuring gear.
Right. What that means it has five charges, and adventuring gear just basically contains mundane items. If you're ever in a situation where you need a torch, then you could say, "Oh, I have a torch in my adventuring gear." You mark off one of the charges, and then you have a torch. If you need a grappling hook, then it's probably just in your adventuring gear. If for some reason you need, I don't know, a pile of dirt, then it's in your adventuring gear.
Okay, cool.
Bag of books does the same thing. It's just a bag with some books in it, and the books are on topics that you want them to be on. So if you need a book on the undead, then you have a book of the undead, and then you just mark off one of the charges and take the book out of the bag. So, William, are you done with picking your spells and all that sort of stuff?
No, not yet. I'm having troubles finding where it says how many I can have.
All right, that's under the commune basic move.
Okay. sort it out to you.
So, Texas, how does it feel to have your wife just judging you soundly from the next room?
There's no, it doesn't, you know, if it's in the next room or the same room, there's no difference. Really.
It goes through the wall.
So, it's, okay. All right, cool. So I get...
So I think it's two spells for you, plus two. Your yeah, plus your yeah, ropes, yeah, which are basically...
Yeah, we'll do the old cure light wounds.
So you have light, sanctify, and guidance. Those three you always have. And then you can pick two first level spells.
Yeah. All right. I mean, if I'm holding you up, carry on. I'll catch up. I'll just read through these.
No, what we need to do now is for you to introduce your characters, and then we can write the bonds with each other. And then once that's done, then we can start.
Okay.
Hodor, what is your character's name again?
My character's name is Thelonious Polonius.
Thelonious Monk Polonius. Okay. Thelonious Polonius?
Polonius, indeed, yes.
So same, one of my bonds is Thelonious Polonius.
Wait, no, don't. We need you to introduce your characters first.
Okay.
Have a look at the Hangout toolbox on the left-hand side, and there's a lower third option there. See if that works for you, so you can enter your actual name or your character name there and your class, because it's not showing up for me, and I'm gonna not remember your character name ever.
Okay. in the tagline, yeah?
I think so. I don't know. I'm using the Dice Streams lower third thing, but...
So, for the people in chat who can see this, nice. This is going to be good.
Okay. I've put...
I'm scared. Also, I'm drinking. Cheers.
Now I'm scared.
Right, well, I've put my character
right
name in a box.
All of you, walk into a bar with the...
Whatever.
Just make up your own things, okay? I'm busy.
Right, there we go. Can you see it at all?
No.
Okay.
How about...
I think it only works when you have your camera switched on.
Ah, okay.
I don't have that. Oh, just okay.
Never mind. That's fine.
Yeah, just... Remember Polonius, you know, character from Hamlet.
Oh, right, okay. Curtain guy.
Yes.
Just Polonius, then.
Mm-hmm. The only role I ever got in the school play of any Shakespearean. I got stabbed behind a curtain.
Whoops. That's
and
a
then
lot
the
of
play
noise
started.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'll try and remember that. Polonius. All right. So... Let's introduce your character. Let's start with Hazel.
Let's get the character sheet out of the way.
Hazel, yeah. Hazel is a halfling thief. He has shifty eyes under messy hair. He prefers dark clothes, and he's slender. He is specialized in avoiding detection and infiltration. And he prefers serpent's tears as his poison of choice.
Poison choice. All right, cool.
Nice.
And what is your alignment?
My alignment is neutral.
Okay, cool. All right, let's move over to...
Accurate, at least. Great, there we go.
Ah, Baldrick. All right.
Okay. Baldrick is a quite a thin guy, but he is dressed in the finest of clothing with a very stylish cap indeed. He has joyous eyes, but little skill. He is, in fact, a neutral human bard. Do you want to do bonds right away, Jaxus, or wait for that?
We'll get to that once we've introduced William's character as well.
Okay, sure thing. Human bard. Do you want to do bonds right away, Jaxus, or wait for that?
We'll get to that once we've introduced William's character as well.
Okay, sure thing. And basically, he has he enjoys reading his songbook in a forgotten tongue, which he doesn't speak, so that's interesting. And a good bit of halfling pipe leaf every now and then, just to take the edge off.
Okay, okay. Have you been acquainted with Hazel, or is this the first time you've gone out on an adventure?
What do you guys think? I know about Hazel. That according to my character, he's...
Okay. All right.
Wait, something's happening here. The stream might be frozen.
Yeah, it's not me. I'll just refresh. Yeah. Finest of clothing. Oh, okay, yeah. Okay, it's back for me. It's back for me. I think it might just be. Yeah, I refreshed.
It's Bach for.
Okay. Yeah.
It works. It works. Okay. Panic.
Yeah. All the panics.
Picnic.
So yeah. Yeah. Indeed. Last heard then. Yeah. Finest of clothing. And indeed, I do know Hazel. I know of Hazel. I don't know if Hazel knows of me.
All right. Well, let's ask Hazel. Do you know of Baldrick the Bard?
Yeah. Yeah. I know him.
All right. Is he famous?
Doesn't sound like you enjoy the fact that you know him.
I know.
Now, is he famous? He is well known, but not famous.
Infamous, maybe.
He's not known for his performance skill, right. But
yep, very true.
Is Baldrick a popular bard, or is he just like oh god, there's Baldrick again?
No, the people value him for his comedy value.
Okay,
Of that is probably unintentional.
All right, cool. All right, let's switch over to Polonius.
Right. Yes, my character is called Thelonious Polonius. He thinks incredibly highly of himself. He has kind eyes, but has strange hair. He has the sort of stereotypical monk cut, like sort of the friar tuck thing with the bald on the top and the ring of hair.
Oi, there's nothing wrong with that kind of haircut. Just so we're clear.
Yeah. He wears long, flowing, ornate robes. They're like white with like yellow hems. They look very pretty. And he keeps them as such. But he is also quite large. He has, as it's described on the sheet, a flabby body. He's not ashamed of his size. He, being a devout follower of the god Morn the Stoic, who believes in... wine and drink and food and a good place to call home. Now, this is a little bit juxtaposed considering that he's out on adventures, but it's because... do we want to reveal, like...
You can,
Okay, cool. Yeah, motivations. He's out looking for a good place to settle down. A good place for him to just go, yep, I like this. I'm going to sit down, I'm going to build a cottage, and I'm going to sit here. I love
the fact that that's a god called the Stoic is the god of good food and drink.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. What's the precept of your religion?
See, now the issue with being a god of food and drink, none of these precepts really sort of line up with that.
One of your own precepts, then that's fine.
Oh, there you go. Okay, well, what we'll do is we'll put it as offering, right? Whenever he enjoys himself a good meal or a good tankard of ale, he has to sort of pour one out.
Oh god, pour one out from a homie in the sky.
That's probably like a proper ritual, right? That's that takes time.
It depends on his lucidity at the time.
All right.
Nice. One appreciates soul.
And would you say that Morn the Stoic is on the spectrum of evil and good, a good god or an evil god?
Well, the lore behind Morn the Stoic says that depending on how often offerings are made to him, he gets basically more progressively more and more drunk, and at that point is when things can start to get kind of rowdy.
So it's like a chaotic type
of... he's probably on the whole, like, you know, nine spectrum. He's probably a chaotic good.
Right, cool. Okay, yeah, nice. He's and are you familiar with Baldrick the Bard?
I'd probably say no. Mostly because I'm not really concerned with bards and what they're about.
Right.
You know, I'm mostly concerned with my religious obligations.
Right. And what do you think of Hazel's thieveries?
As long as he's making his proper offerings to Morn, then, you know, okay. As long as he doesn't steal from me.
Right. And what was your alignment again?
My alignment is lawful.
All right, cool.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, so now that we've established this, there is a number of bonds on your character sheet, and there's probably four, and you can also write your own. What I want you to do is fill in at least three, and then have at least one bond with every other character.
But so what is, because I have one bond with both of them, fill those in already. So the third one, is it, I mean, it has to be still one of the people in here, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So you just don't want three with one person. That's
yeah. Okay. Yeah. No, yeah. You need to have at least one bond with someone else.
No, don't. Hang on.
That's mainly for coherency, right? Because otherwise there'd be no reason for you guys to actually go out adventuring with each other.
Oh, God.
Once these bonds help you roleplay, and they can also be resolved. And when at the end of a session you feel that, or both you and the person you have a bond with feel that the bond is no longer applicable, it's resolved, or you've gotten out all of it that you could have gotten out of it in a roleplay sense, then you can resolve the bond and you get to mark XP for it. And then you write a new bond with either the same character, a different character, an NPC, a god, or a town, or whatever. But right now it has to be the player characters.
Come on.
Bonds are also used for the aid or interfere move. Because when you want to aid someone, you have to roll the number of bonds you have with them. And then so it's 2d6 plus the number of bonds. And then you can aid or interfere with someone. And aiding just gives the person a flat plus one. Interfering gets them a minus two. So if there's someone you actually hate, you can interfere with them.
Cool.
Shall I start by reading out my bonds?
Yeah, please do. Yeah.
Are the bonds public or are
they? They are public.
Private?
Yes. Yeah.
They are public.
Because if one of the other player characters thinks feels that these bonds are really like. That they don't really apply, or they feel that they're incorrect or whatever, then they can sort of veto it. It doesn't really happen often because most of these bonds are quite straightforward.
Well, I stole something from Thelonious.
Oh, dear.
Getting details about me.
Oh, nice. Nice. Now, it's up to Thelonious whether or not, or it's basically up to you guys whether or not we define those incriminating details now. Or if we decide on them
fun,
later.
It might be fun to figure out later once we get some context.
Because that way I can pull that one out of the bag.
Right, cool.
Oh, I almost want to change one now because it would be hilarious.
All right, Baldrick, what are your bonds?
Okay, I'm going to keep them the same. Never mind. I was thinking of changing one.
Details now? Or if we... decide
it might
on
be
them
fun.
Later.
It might be fun to figure out later once we get some context.
Because that way I can pull that one out of the bag.
Right, cool.
Oh, I almost want to change one now because it would be hilarious.
All right, Baldrick, what are your bonds?
I'm going to keep them the same. Never mind. I was thinking of changing one. I have. Polonius is often the butt of my jokes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm writing a ballad about the adventures of Hazel.
No? Wow.
And Polonius does not trust me. And for good reason.
Nice. Nice.
So basically, Polonius knows incriminating evidence about Hazel, and he doesn't trust Baldrick. So basically, he is our adult supervision of our little duo.
Oh my god!
Perfect. But if you're our parole officer.
So I'm basically your designated driver, but I'm the one who worships the god of drink.
Yeah. What, cool. what if you're our parole officer? Brilliant. We were just released from some kind of prison and you're the one that's supposed to keep us in line.
And I'm like, I'm going to keep you in line, boys. Let me show you how.
we could stick with that if you want.
Cool. Yeah, it sounds fine to me. Cool.
All right, cool. Polonius, what are your bonds?
My bonds. Baldric has insulted my deity. I do not trust them.
Probably because you're the butt of his joke. Of his jokes,
and for good reason.
Those jokes probably consisted of blasphemous remarks. Now here's one. Hazel is a good and faithful person. I trust them implicitly.
Wait, what?
That's because you know shit about Hazel.
I have all the dirt, so I'm like, well, there's nothing you could do to me at this point. I trust you completely. I am currently working on converting Baldric to my faith.
Nope, nice. Nope. That's not going to happen.
We'll see about that.
Working on.
Okay, cool. Get ready to play, everyone. Do we need a minor break for this? Or do you say, let's just carry on?
I could grab a drink.
Let's go for a 2-minute break then, and we'll be
Right. Cool. Okay, somebody, entertain the viewers.
Hello, my baby. Hello, my honey. Hello, my ragtime girl.
Wow.
Yeah, hello.
Yeah, okay. We're still here, or at least I am. Not sure why. Let's see now, because this is where I need to come up with your adventure. Yeah, cool. Okay. I'll be right back, guys.
Haha, there we go. Alive again. Where are we here? Aldo was singing? Wait, what? I missed that?
You did. I entertained the stream while you were gone.
That is amazing. I'm the bard and you're doing all the singing here.
Oh, I know a fair few drinking songs. To clarify, when you said that you thought it was funny that a god named the Stoic was the one of drink. He's named so over his resilience to the intoxicating effects of drink.
Ah, yes, the endurance that you get and the ability to remain functional.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This is going to be good. These bonds are perfect now. I'm loving this idea. This is going to be crazy, though. I think last time I played this with Jexes, then it was sort of all around a physical table. I think, did one person die or two people? I don't know. It was just crazy, though. But the great thing is, you know, the moves make it really easy, as far as I'm concerned, to really jump in, because you really can just go like, I punch him, what's that? Oh, this move. And then it's always roll 2d6.
Cool. Oh, wow. Because I'm a human cleric, I can get a first level wizard spell.
That's not bad. Wait, what's happening here? Ghost with the host. The ghost host. Thank you so much, buddy. Really appreciate that support. Ghost has actually been here ages. Ghost has been here back when I was playing Crusader Kings. Welcome back.
Cool. Note that down.
Excuse me. Okay. Are we ready?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Yep, I'm all ready to go.
Right. I think the three of you find yourself on a path leading away from a town. A town that was not particularly pleased with the actions of both Hazel and Baldric.
Oi.
How could that possibly be?
I don't know.
I was a perfect gentleman the entire time.
So the magistrate has asked Polonius to kindly escort these fellows out and teach them something about the world and maybe convert them to a better way of life than rampant thievery and probably public drunkenness.
I like to think that as we're walking down the road, I'm sort of speaking loudly, telling you about the errors of your ways and how you should live your life well, and you're just sort of trudging along behind me going, ugh.
Exactly.
I said, you're completely right. Can I take off these bonds though now?
I don't think you would have been bound though. It's more like being run out of town. Because I don't know. Maybe the evidence wasn't
so torches and pitchforks. Or...
yeah, and yeah. You know, maybe some black tar and feathers.
Yeah. Was I run out too?
So where
was I just sort of
going at a brisk pace?
I think so, and I think also the magistrate has picked Polonius because I don't think Polonius was really a good, you know, sort of influencing factor in the magistrate's opinion.
Yeah, perhaps the rowdiness. He was talking like, to the tavern.
We need to banish these people to the edges of our kingdom. Let's send that guy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and then when you sort of leave, you hear the crowd cheering. It's like, yeah, they're gone. But yeah, you find yourself on a road, how long have you been traveling?
Together or down this road specifically? Yeah,
together down this road.
Hmm. I don't know. I imagine that after we. I mean, the.
It feels like hours. That's for sure.
Yeah. Probably the teachings of Morn the Stoic would say that when one is lost along a lonely road, you have to burn sky until you see lines. Essentially, and you just keep going and see where the path takes you, and trust that all will be well.
So you have no idea where you're going.
Nope. Probably completely lost as well.
Do the others know that you have no idea where you're going?
Nope. I am just, you know, I'm like. Marching down the road, maybe whistling something as we go.
I'm just trudging behind going, nobody knows the trouble I've seen.
Right, yeah. So, yeah, what do you want to do, guys?
Hey, want to make a run for it?
It's, I think, basically you're sort of on the road. There's open fields, not much vegetation, mostly like grain fields or something like that.
I imagine if you've been out there for a while, maybe I'm starting to get a little thirsty. Is there like a house, like a farm?
I don't know. Why? Let's discern realities, Polonius.
Oh, okie doke. How does do that?
I'll scroll. There's at the first page of the document.
It's fairly easy. You roll 2d6. Anything you do is pretty much 2d6.
Yeah. Usually. So basically, let me read this out so everyone knows. Mm-hmm. Discern realities. When you closely study a situation or person, roll plus wisdom. On a 10 plus, you can ask the GM three questions from the list below. On a 7 to 9, you ask one. Take plus one forward when acting on the answers. Now, what does that mean? It means you get a plus one bonus to the next roll you do in relation to one of those answers.
Okay.
So forward means on the next roll. Ongoing means on every other role you do from then from that point onwards.
Okay, cool. So I roll 2d6 plus my wisdom, yes?
Yes, exactly. Yep.
Okay. I rolled a 11.
All right, so you get to ask me 3 questions.
Is there...
From that list.
Oh, okay.
Otherwise it'd be too easy.
What is there useful or valuable to me?
Well, I think you were looking for a farmhouse, right? I think in the distance, you do notice a larger building, like shape of a building. Whether or not it's a farmhouse or anything else, you can't really tell because it's too far away, but there's definitely something there.
So okay. you were saying we were walking along farmland here, right?
Yeah.
So if I want to find out, like, is there a big cornfield, can I just say, like, there's a big cornfield next to us, or do I have to discern realities as well?
No, I think, you know, I already stated there's just, like, grain fields and cornfields. If you want a okay. field with high vegetation, there's a field with high vegetation.
Perfect. I want to
ask suddenly... two questions before you do something, so...
Yeah, I want to signal something to Hazel. Just basically go to Hazel, like you know,
all right.
Just silently okay. sort of, yeah.
Let's finish up these two other questions, and then we'll okay. we got to that.
Oh, you got 3 in total. Cool.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, what one of them is what happened here? Could I extend that to what happened there recently?
Yes, you can. You notice that there's a flock of crows flying over the building.
Okay.
So yeah, you can deduce mm-hmm. from that what you will. Mm-hmm. But it's too far away to see exactly what's been going on. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then because of that, I shall then ask, what here is not what it appears to be?
I think. There's a definite absence of birds or of sound. Basically, you hear the wind rustling, the grain rustling, and you hear the crows in the distance.
But other than that,
that's it. That's absolutely it.
Hmm.
Except for Baldrick's terrible singing.
I just imagine one chicken just quack, 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 and you hear another shh. Oh.
All right. Well, in that case, I will. I would like to turn to my two companions and say, "We've been traveling down this road for quite some time. What do you say? Perhaps something to eat, something to drink. I'm sure some of the locals will be able to accommodate us."
I look demonstrably around, going, "Where do you see locals?"
I'm sure there's people over there. And I point over yonder at the house circled by crows.
Oh, an ominous farmhouse. Yeah, that marvelous. What
could possibly go wrong?
At the very least, we could there's crows to eat. Somebody has a bow, an arrow. Yes.
Yes.
Exactly. We could put you can start repaying your debt of. Debt of morals, shall we say.
Wait, are you just inventing that debt right now?
Not at all. It's... You were run out of that town, and I was sent with you. You can start working off that debt to me right now. Shoot a couple of those crows so we can eat.
We'd have to get closer, though. I mean...
Of course. Onwards.
Oh, you want to move up?
Yeah. I have a bad feeling about this.
Yes.
Sure, that Hazel is towards the back of the group.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, no, I will take the lead and begin to walk towards the farmhouse.
Right. I'm along. So, yeah, you're trudging through... Oh, yeah, sorry.
So behind Polonia's back, I whisper to Baldrick, saying, "Now let's just stick around for a bit. If he is going to provide food and drink, I'm okay with that. Just
that sounds good.
Better than staking out by just the two of us.
That's a good. As Polonius is walking forward, I'm gonna walk along and then sort of slow down to sort of so that we increase that distance and we're just standing here like.
Yeah. Oh no, I don't. I probably don't even notice. I'm just quite happily just walking towards sort of, you know, I'm not power walking as such, but I'm eager to get to my destination.
Right. Yeah, you found the destination. You just want to get there, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. No. I guess you're walking through the, let's make it a cornfield, and it's high. You can't really see far, you know, you can't see up in the distance. You can't see much to your left and your right. Basically, all you can see is corn in your face.
Yeah, and I imagine crows maybe circling above something, and
exactly,
I'm heading in the direction.
Exactly, yeah.
Nothing ever bad happens to cornfields.
No, you're getting closer. I think, you know, if you want, you can sort of approach the building or whatever. Just let me know what you want to do.
Okay, well, yeah, if I'm there, is there a door?
Well, you know, let's take a step back and see. I think if you when you exit the cornfield, basically there's a large open space, and it the building does look like a grand farmhouse, like a something that used to be owned by a rich farmers, basically. So there's there's several wings. There's a, you know, two-story building. A couple of outhouses and a large shed.
Outhouses right next to each other.
But there's like basically so it's a sort of like a square with a large gate, and then the house sort of like in a U shape around that square. If you see what I mean.
Kind of like that manor house, right? With an east wing and a west wing, something like
that?
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. Exactly like that. It's basically the same shape.
Okay.
The house looks abandoned. It doesn't look dilapidated or, you know, in ruins, but it's been a while since people have been there.
Are the windows boarded up or anything?
No, but the glass is broken. For some of the windows.
Okay, so that means that people have been trying to get in.
Yeah.
I imagine.
Turn on your witcher sense.
Exactly. Find the red glow.
There's trolls here.
Can we look in the into the courtyard, or are the gates closed?
No, the gate is
the gate is open. Reality.
The gate is open. You can just look into the courtyard, and you'll see a well there. Yeah, like a stone, like pretty large stone well, mm-hmm. Which looks in quite a good shape, as opposed to the rest of the surroundings. It's like there's bits of grass growing where there shouldn't have been grass growing, you know, amongst the cobblestones, and it looks like abandoned, but it's quiet apart from the wah, wah of crows flying overhead. There are a lot crows flying overhead.
When you say a lot, do you mean like just, you know, dozens, or literally like hundreds, like creepily many?
Somewhere in between those two numbers.
Like one for a million.
It's more than you'd expect there to be. You know, having a flock, you know, like a murder of crows flying around is not that weird. But having two or three of them, that's a bit, it's iffy.
So it's a bit like a serial murder.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. All right, then. I will look back at my... Because I imagine I'm still sort of the head of this group. I'll look back to my two people, sort of looking as though... Is there anything they particularly want to do? Because if not, I will sort of take charge here. And
Hazel is perfectly happy having Polonius take charge.
Very well. In that case, I will take a step, however many steps is necessary to get just outside the gates. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to call inside, like, "Hello, friends! It is I, Polonius! I've come to see! Come to raid your larders!"
All right. Why don't you roll a Defy Danger Charisma check for me?
Okay.
Which Defy Danger says, when you act despite an imminent threat or suffer a calamity, say how you deal with it and roll, and if you do it using charm and social grace, use charisma. Well, in this case, you are shouting. and using a pleasant voice to attract something.
Mm-hmm. So in the meantime, I'm thinking Hazel and I are just standing to the side, like crossed arms. I just pass you a little bit of that, you know, halfling pipe. We like, you want? Yeah.
Sure. Wow.
Okay, cool. Let's see. I rolled a 10.
A 10. All right. Yeah, on the 10 plus, you do what you set out to, and the threat doesn't come to bear. So what I had planned doesn't come to bear. No. there is no answer. You do notice that some of the crows are sort of pecking at the ground and stuff. They get scared and they fly off. Yeah, and I think one of the crows is so startled that it drops an item on the ground.
And I clearly notice this just sort of
okay, okay.
Yeah. It makes a sort of squishy sound.
Calling it now. Oh, squishy, never mind. I was saying gonna say calling it now, it's gonna be a finger or something.
okay. I look probably a little bit startled. And I'll approach it.
Alright. Yeah. Yeah, you it's definitely an eyeball, but you know, but not pristine. It's pecked at. It's sort of like popped open, and there's like bits and viscera hanging.
I want to move up to the gate so I can at least see like Polonius doing things, like just being there, like.
Yeah.
I'm one step behind Baldrick.
I'll peer over, look at this thing, and go, look, turn back to my friends and say, "Well, I wasn't expecting to see that."
Wait, I thought Baldrick was the one with the bad parts.
Wait, we don't see this, right? We don't know that it's an eye.
No, it's just the cleric turning towards you, saying, "I didn't expect you
to see that." I'm just turning to Hazel like, "Okay, awkward."
So I'll imagine that of the three of us, I'd imagine that Hazel's probably the one that's seen the most combat. Would I be correct in that assumption? Like, would I know that about Hazel, maybe?
I don't know. Well, let's ask Hazel.
Hazel?
Combat, not as much. But, you know, the occasional backstab or a poisoned arrow from a darkened corner. Yeah, mm-hmm. Sure.
Okay, combat? Yes. No. Shiving? Yeah.
Okay. I'd like to call back to Hazel and say, Hazel, we seem to have what appears to be an eye. Come see what you can make of it.
Okay.
Wait, when you say an eye, what do you mean, like the letter? What are we talking about?
Oh, no, eye clean, you know, right out of somebody's head. I sort of peer upwards, seeing the crows still circling around. I was like, I imagine one of those crows had it.
I walk on over, going, say, "Oh, okay, wait, I need to see this."
Okay.
I guess as soon as I see it, I turn around and go, "Oh, okay, I didn't need to see that. Never mind."
I think it's time for a discern reality from Hazel.
Yeah. So you walk up to Polonius, right?
Yes, and I look him in the eye, or
try to.
Wait, what eye?
the eye he's holding.
Right, yeah.
So discern reality is
plus wisdom.
6 plus wisdom. Yeah, I have a +0, so my result is 9.
On a 7 to 9, you can ask one of the questions from the list.
Oh, okay, so it's not that bad.
No. Oh, by the way. How do you gain XP in this game? Whenever you roll a 6 or lower, bad stuff happens, but you gain XP. So you learn by failing. And you go level up by adding 7 to the current level of your character. So right now that'd be 8 XP. Once you have 8 XP and you camp, or you have a moment to yourself, like about an hour, you can level up instantly. So cool. That's the smaller side. Go ahead. Ask me a question.
What here is useful or valuable to me?
What would you consider to be valuable? What does Hazel think is valuable?
Well, we've been run out of town sort of spontaneously, so we don't have much in the form of food or drink. Being a halfling, that's a thing for me. So travel supplies.
Okay. Yeah.
I'd be interested in those.
Yeah, I think there's a sort of barn connected to the it's on the square basically. So you have to imagine that this is like quite a big area. And I think, you know, the doors are half open and you can see that there's some bits of grain sort of lying on the floor there. There might be some useful stuff in there in terms of rations.
Go ahead. I think you're still up.
And the eye, can I make out what it is? It a human eye? Is it a goat's eye?
Find some lore on the eye. Which would be a 2d6 plus your intelligence score.
Okay.
So when you consult your accumulated knowledge about something, you roll plus intelligence. On a 10 plus, the GM will tell you something interesting and useful about the subject relevant to your situation.
I like that it's interesting and useful.
Yeah. On a 7 to 9, the GM will only tell you something interesting. It's up to you to make it useful. The GM might ask you, for instance, how do you know this? And then you tell me the truth.
Okay. So my intelligence is plus one. So this is an 8.
An 8. Okay. Yeah. You get to you want to know about the eye. So I get to tell you something interesting about the eye. It is an eye of a small child.
Okay.
So we're going there, huh?
Wow. Do you share that information with me? Hazel?
Yeah. Why not? Why not?
How would you know that it's the eye of a small child?
Well, actually, it could also be a halfling eye.
It could be.
I guess so. I don't know. Maybe the people that lived here were halflings, but this also probably means that someone or something brought them into a state such that their eyes could be pecked out by crows.
The important question is, how do you recognize a kid's eyes?
It's small, like a kid's eye or a halfling's eye.
Well,
something happened, Hazel.
Well, there was this episode with a poisoned arrow from a dark corner.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Now we're getting down to it. Okay, cool. Go ahead, Baldrick. You wanted to.
I'm just gonna go like, oh, dude, this is freaking me out. This is freaking me out. I'm not dealing with this. And I'm gonna lay my hand on Polonius's shoulder. And the other hand, uncomfortably, like, right here on his neck, like, looking him straight in the face, like, I'm freaking out, man. And I'm going to use Charming and Open. When you speak frankly with someone, you can ask their player a question from the list below. They must answer truthfully, and they must also may also ask you a question from the same list.
Yeah. So which I'm going to answer truthfully as well.
Absolutely. So I'm going to ask Polonius, dude, I mean, I'm freaking out. What are you really feeling right now?
Where is this list of questions so that I can?
It's with the bard.
It's on page 5.
Page 5.
Nice one.
Oh, okay. Actually, page 5. Okay. All right. I sort of look at you and I say, "Well, I'm feeling rather sorrowful right now. It seems to be that there's a." Child's eye that has been dropped before us. It's rather disconcerting, actually. I was in rather good spirits up until now.
You are indeed a servant of Morn the Stoic. Just, it is rather disconcerting.
Yeah. Okay. And so I can ask one to you, yes?
Yeah, you can. Yep.
Absolutely. One off. Wait, let me put it up for the stream as well. One off the list. There we go.
I'm going to sort of twist the "what do you wish I would do" question and say, what do you think we should do? Like, how should we proceed? Do you think, Aldrich?
Okay, as in, what do you wish I would do, since you're sort of the, right now, the little quote-unquote leader? what do you wish I would do? Okay, what should we do? Well, my money is for bypassing all of this, just moving on to the street, just to the next city, just to the next village. Forget about this. Maybe drink until we get some kind of Alzheimer's, or just anyway destroy the memory of all of this.
Well, I would agree with you on the drinking part, but I feel as though that this debt of which I've been speaking, this debt of morality to the betterment of the world and mankind at large, could be best served now, as a matter of fact. We could discern what's going on here. Seems as though something is definitely afoot.
Or an eye.
Or an eye.
Terrible. Terrible!
Hazel, what do you think?
I'd like to do two things. The first is, I'd like to get my bow out.
Done.
And the second is, I'd like to
shoot Polonius. Take,
take a look in the barn and see if we can get any supplies there for our trip, and then book it to the next town.
Okay. Yeah. The barn door is open, and I think as you cautiously approach it, as you would. It's dark inside, but you do hear some concerning sounds. Exactly, that's what you hear. Yeah.
Some moaning.
Yeah, and some retching and some shuffling.
Okay.
Sounds like the last battle party. Hazel,
what do you do?
I think I notch an arrow on my bow and shout into the barn, "Hello, is anybody there?"
All right, I think this would be the point where you would also defy danger in a charismatic way.
Let's defy danger in a charismatic way. Hold on, where do I find...
Also, hold on with the roll, let's see. Now, I think as you shout or say hello, is anyone there? There's a bit of a pause in the groaning and the shuffling as you sort of feel a couple of entities shifting their attention towards the door, and that's just like a split second, and then they move quite a bit faster towards the door. Which is where you defy danger by getting out of the way or acting fast, I think. But it's up to you to decide what you want to do. There's a couple of entities moving towards you, fast.
I get out of the way. and I want to make sure that either Polonius or Baldrick is between them and me.
Absolutely.
Well, me and Baldrick are sort of currently having our heart-to-heart.
Yeah, at the will.
Emotional heart to heart.
But roll the let's roll the defy danger dexterity check.
Okay, so I have a +2 on dexterity, so this is an 11.
Yes, well done. On a 10+, you do what you set out to. The threat to you doesn't come to bear. You manage to nimbly and quite quickly retreat from the barn door as you see sort of like rotting arms trying to grasp at you, trying to grab you through the doorway. And you haven't seen any like of the figures fully, but you do see that their arms are nasty. And I imagine that you, as you say, you retreat behind Polonius, somewhere behind the well, probably taking cover. With the bow at the ready, I think.
Yeah, so me and Baldrick are sort of having our heart-to-heart discussion, and then Hazel just sort of comes scurrying around.
Yeah, do you make any sounds, Hazel, or is this a completely like quiet scene? Because there's a... That's relevant.
No, I think I will give a little squeak of surprise.
Okay.
Mm. I imagine that's probably drowned out from...
Exactly. Do you think that Baldrick and Polonius would hear that little sort of squeak of surprise?
I'm not sure how deep in each other's eyes they are looking, but they will notice me running up behind them.
Okay.
And certainly Baldrick will have an idea of what that means.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm like, I have my hand like on your neck, and it's like I hear that. Ah!
Yeah,
sort of that sort of. Uh-oh.
I think when you do that sort of, you know, sort of looking around, you also instead of those two arms, you see a couple of figures moving out of the barn. Yeah, they sort of scurry up on twisted legs. Part of their entrails are hanging out. There's blood on their like on their cheeks and coming out of their mouths. Their lips are sort of drawn back, so you can see the entire mouth, like the teeth. And their arms have grown sort of like talons. Their nails are really sharp and long. And they have noticed.
Oh God, it's Bloodborne.
And as they've noticed you, you hear them say stuff, but you can't understand what it is. But they're definitely talking.
I kind of just want to you know, while I'm there with Polonius, sort of just like, you know, slap him like that a little bit on the cheek, like nice talk, buddy. Talk to you later, okay? And just, you know, run off to after Hazel.
Hazel's basically sitting right.
Yeah, so
he's actually sitting here. Oh, yeah. No, then I'm
behind
going,
Hazel.
Then I'm going, I run exactly that. I run after behind Hazel. Just he's like, hoop, behind me, and I just go behind him.
Okay. I imagine at this point.
You hear this. You, there's like retching noises and talk.
Okay.
In a sort of frenetic, like frantic manner.
Okay.
These creatures want something from you guys specifically.
Okay. They are quite clearly undead, yes? I mean, in terms of guts and stuff hanging out,
I'd say that they're undead, yes.
Okay, cool. So then as they're approaching us, they're not like legging it towards us, trying to get at us.
They are.
Oh, okay, they are doing that.
Yeah, they're coming straight for you.
Oh, okay then.
There's three right now, and I think Hazel has heard more than three.
Okay. Well, in that case, I will see them and say, oh, bother. Reach into a little pouch that I have that's sewn onto the front of my, in front of my robes, and pull out a little talisman. I'll then sort of cup it in my hands and begin to chant, and I want to cast Turn Undead.
All right, go ahead.
Still the whole 2d6 thing? Yes.
Yeah, 2d6 plus wisdom. 2d6 plus. It's always 2d6, and then we add a number.
What does that little talisman look like for more of the Stoic?
What is it? What?
Well, I imagine it's not very large. It's probably about the size of, you know, just slightly smaller than the palm, and it almost looks like a copper coin. Like a large copper coin. I'd probably argue that you wouldn't be able to tell quite what's on it, considering that I've probably got my back to you and I take it out of a pocket and then clasp it in my hands. I mean, if you really want to know, maybe I could say, but...
And so you're wearing this talisman on your clothes?
Oh, no, it's in a pocket. It's in like a little pouch in my robes.
Okay.
It's like a little pouch on the front.
Given the fact that looks like money, and I stole it from you, how probable is it that I have your talisman instead of you?
I totally agree. I reach into my pocket. I even begin, like, I even close my eyes, and I begin reciting just in, you know, anticipation of it being there.
At that point, I think just when you realize that there's nothing in that pocket that will allow you to turn these undead, they start grabbing at you, and you feel their talons trying to scratch at you. What do you do?
Okay, they mean me ill. You know, they mean me harm. Yes, they are attacking me.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. In which case, I would like to draw my warhammer, if it's possible, and slap him in the face with it.
Gently, just
then I think you'd be first defying danger by quick thinking, i.e. drawing out your weapon, taking a step back, and then attacking. So let's do that first, and then if successful, you get to do a hack and slash, and otherwise stuff happens to you.
Okay, so I'm rolling the defy danger with
intelligence.
Cool. My intelligence, let me check my intelligence. Okay, I get plus one. Roll. Oh dear, I got a four.
All right. Mark XP, you get one XP.
Yay! <Nice. laughs>
Yes.
So
of
that's
these,
the good news.
The good news is that you mark XP. The bad news is
I get torture shreds.
Yes. not necessarily happening right now, but it's imminent. There's these three creatures. Two of them have started trying to claw and gnaw at you, and I will roll damage for them. The third one sort of bypasses you and has his mindset on that tasty little halfling that ran away. So that one's charging at you, Hazel. So we'll get to that one once we've done this. Two of these ghouls. Do you have armor, Polonius?
I do. I have chainmail.
Okay, so that's one, right? That's one armor. Okay, so that negates one damage. Okay, unfortunately for you, these guys have piercing, so they pierce one. Okay. And let me roll that one. There's no way to add flat numbers to this, right?
No.
Okay.
You just roll.
So that would be a 6 damage to you as they start gnawing on your arms and try to grab at your neck.
Okay, yeah.
And you are sort of basically clinched with them. And the smell coming off these guys is insane. It's absolutely foul. It smells like sickly sweet mixed with this sort of like that bad breath you have when you've snored all night long and you haven't had a drink of water. You know, that bad smell.
I would imagine that Polonius has woken up in a few pigsties after a vendor, so...
Do we have like the time for us to like for Hazel and me to sort of look at each other, and I can go like, I have a prop. I have actual props for me to actually look at Hazel and just go like, was that you? What that?
You can. It has no effect whatsoever on the outcome.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
If you want to do that as your action, so to speak, then
absolutely.
I think Hazel, you see this. Yeah, let's call it a ghoul because that's what it is.
Okay.
Run at you, trying to sort of like lunge at you with these long clawed hands. Trying to swipe at you. What do you do?
I shoot them in the eye.
So you sort of want to power through the attack and
let's do a volley.
Okay.
I feel brave today.
Sure, let's do that. You had your bow out already, so you'd have the time to shoot before it sort of hits you.
I have a plus two. On Dex?
Yeah, right. That's a 10 plus.
So that's...
You have a clear shot, so you can deal your damage, and you have a damage die somewhere in the middle.
So that's 8 for a thief. Oh.
Nice.
Yeah, the 8. So I deal him exactly 2 damage.
All right. I need to...
Oh, and of course the arrow was poisoned.
Was it now? Is the what was your poison of choice again?
Serpent's tears.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Anyone dealing damage to the target rolls twice and takes the better result.
Nice.
Okay, so roll again. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Okay.
I'm not sure if it applies now, but let's make it apply now. That's an 8. Absolutely phenomenal. Yeah. You you fire your arrow like close range, right? Sort of in the chest. It sort of staggers back and it falls to the ground, and it sort of lies there half dazed, but it's trying to get up again. Baldrick, what do you do? Because there's this ghoul sort of lumbering past you trying to get at Hazel, and there's these two guys trying to rip Polonius apart. And there's more. There's two more coming out of the bar now.
So I'm thinking, I have arcane art. I can weave performance into a basic spell, but I don't think I have any spells. They're at least not in my starting moves. So I'm assuming that's the advanced moves, right?
No. No. What it is is the spells. the spell is literally one of those four effects.
Oh right. So
you do a performance, and that becomes a basic spell with the effect of healing, giving someone a bonus damage die, shaking clear of an enchantment, or being more successful with an aid. Excuse me.
Tell the worst pun you've ever told in your life and make them cringe themselves to death.
Unfortunately, I can't. I have no damage with that. I'm thinking though. I'm going to stand behind Hazel, sort of massage his shoulders and like, come on, buddy, you can do this. You can do this. I believe in you, buddy. Just like back in Covey, man. Come on, you can do this.
All right,
and to give you a plus 1d4 forward to damage.
Okay, cool. Absolutely. Polonius. Just
dance like a butterfly. Sting like a bee. You were the greatest.
What do you do? These guys will try and rip you apart if you're not careful.
Yeah. I'm probably a little bit disconcerted about the disappearance of my talisman, actually. but it's probably not so much that I'm unable to act. Let me see. Hang on, let me just check to see what this does. Because as a human cleric, I can choose one wizard spell.
Absolutely, yes.
And I chose Contact Spirits, and I want to see what I want to read that again. Oh no, it's just a question thing. It's not like I can't say, "Help me, spirits, help me."
No.
No. Okay. In that case, I can't heal myself with Cure Light Wounds, can I? It says heal an ally you touch.
Yeah, no, that's an ally.
Yeah, so it's not. I can't be like, I'd love. I, you know.
But you can sort of power through their attacks by, just withstanding them with a strength defy danger, or you can try and break away, which would also be a strength check, I think, in this case, because you don't have the space to do a sort of dexterity based move. And then you can do like an attack or do something else, move away, whatever.
Okay.
It's what you want to do. It's
All right then. I think I will just try and I'll try and endure with a defined injury. I'm on the ropes here. I'm arms up. You know, trying to deflect.
Okay, so it's a defy danger plus constitution check in that case.
Yeah. So 2d6. Cool. That's 11.
All right. Awesome. I think you just managed to shake him off. You just sort of stand there with your chainmail is being more effective than it was before.
I am.
Yeah,
I do have
you are quite burly as well.
I am. Yes.
So I think you just maybe use your belly to sort of punch him out of the way and
Kung Fu Panda them.
Yeah. Exactly. There's a bit of space between you and these two, and there's two more guys running up. I think They are still not sure what the threat is here, so they are undecided as to what they're going to do. But what do you want to do about these two guys who are trying to eat you?
Sorry, who?
You.
Probably. Oh, me. Sorry. Yeah. Sorry. I thought my turn was over.
Okay. So we don't really have that strict sort of turn.
Well, no. There's no. It's like a sort of narrative flow.
Oh, okay.
I think in this case you sort of managed to sort of bump them out of the way, and then you get to do something because that's sort of like a natural thing that you do.
Okay. The one that Hazel has just shot with an arrow. How far away is that one from me? Like, would it be a case like maybe get to turn around and just whack him? Golf club.
I think you'd be able to do that. Yeah, I don't think there's that much space between. Or maybe you have to take another step or whatever, but that's fine. Yeah. You can do that. No
All right,
problem.
I'll try to do that. I'll grip the warhammer with two hands. I'll sort of see it sort of stumble back from this arrow. That's maybe I can see the other end poking out of its back.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe that's what I want to do. I'm going to want to try and sort of hammer the arrow like back through.
Okay.
Nice. Just whack it, but try and hit the arrow back through.
Okay, wow. So, roll a hack and slash.
Okay, and that is
2d6 plus 0 strength.
My strength is awful, so doesn't matter. But it doesn't matter. That is a 7.
Okay. On a 7-9, you deal your damage to the enemy, and the enemy makes an attack against you.
Okay.
So deal your damage.
Okay.
Don't forget to roll twice and take the best result.
Yeah.
Wait. Is that for everyone? Who had that one?
It's the poison's effect on the.
Oh. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
How do I see what damage my warhammer is?
You have a damage die, and for a cleric, I think.
So it doesn't matter. It's not weapon based.
It's a D6.
It is a D6. Yes. Okay. Cool.
So you roll 2D6 and take the highest result.
Cool. 4.
Okay. I think before this creature has a chance to turn around and start swiping at you, you sort of hammer the arrow back through it, but you also take away part of its chest with your warhammer. what are you using? A mace or?
It's a warhammer. It's specifically
a warhammer. Yeah. Definitely.
Is,
you
is
break
it,
away.
Part is it 40k?
It weighs a 40k.
Mm-hmm. Oh. And I think Hazel is sort of splattered in gore from the attack.
I think
Baldrick as well, because he's sort of taller. So the both of you are sort of covered in gunk.
I throw up a little, just like
through the hole. You see this flabby, amazing cleric, sort of with the hammer going. Yeah,
gotcha.
Hazel, what's your reaction to this? What do you do? So this guy is definitely dead, by the way, if that wasn't clear.
He's dead, not undead dead.
He's completely destroyed.
Okay, cool. So that strengthens my resolve to stay behind Polonius.
All of us are just ducking behind Polonius.
I think... I will try to offer some long-range support to him and shoot one of the other ghouls.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. And this arrow is not poisoned.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's an 8.
Okay, on a 7-9, you get to choose one. You deal your damage. But you have to choose one of these three things. You have to move to get the shot, placing you in danger of the GM's choice. You have to take what you can get, minus 1d6 damage. Or you have to take several shots, reducing your ammo count by 1.
Okay. I'm going to choose to move.
Okay.
Because I want also to get out of the splatter zone. From Polonius splatter zone.
I think you are so focused on one of these on these ghouls that you sort of move out of the way more towards the in between the barn and the farmhouse, as opposed to in between the barn and the well, basically. As you move there, you draw attention to yourself from these two ghouls that came up running out of the barn. So they've definitely noticed you and they're coming straight for you. But you get to roll your damage. They
okay,
won't get
and
to
I
you
did
right
a,
now.
I got a extra d4.
Yes, that's the bardic yes. Thing.
Okay.
Arcane art.
Oh. Whoops. Sorry. Disregard the
9d6s. Right? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, you definitely hit one another square in the chest again, and it stumbles back from Polonius, whereas the other one is definitely trying to grab at him while his back is turned. This one is has taken some, you know, he's sort of dazed, he's stunned.
Can I sort of move in on that then? I have absolutely. My short sword, at least sort of, you know, check my arrows, see that there's just three of them and go like, just grab my short sword and kind of want to, you know, not really get in there, but sort of stab at him a little bit.
Tickle him.
Which one?
The one that's stumbling back. So, you know, I'm in the habit of, you know, Hazel sets them up and maybe I just sort of, you know, if they're still squirming on the ground, I'll stab
them. That does sort of mean that you have to brush past the one that's trying to attack Polonia. So you are putting yourself in a bit of a position for danger. There's no other way around it.
Why don't I do that? No, then it's more sensible that I hit the one sort of attacking Polonia. Try and keep the ones away from me as much as I can.
Okay, roll a hack and slash.
Okay, yeah, that was, what was it again? Roll plus strength, right?
Yeah.
So that is minus one. 2d6, was it?
2d6 mm-hmm. minus one, yes.
Okay, perfect. Rolling, that is...
That's XP.
That is XP, at least.
That's XP, is what that is.
That's a good one. Where do I mark it on these sheets, actually? Ah, there we go.
On the bottom right, yeah. I think.
There we go, yeah, bottom right.
Right.
Why did I have to take an action in combat?
Yeah, I think you move up, trying to sort of slash and try to, you know, drive the creature off Polonius. And
if you hit me,
you do not hit Polonius. No, the danger is completely on Baldrick here. This creature is absolutely not afraid of you. You keep swiping at it. You have no idea how this short sword currently
I will,
how it works.
I will scream very manly in a very manly, deep sort of.
Yeah, and I think you sort of stumble and you barrel into this creature, but it's strong, right? And as you barrel into it, it sort of stands where it was, and it grabs you in a great crushing hug as it sinks its teeth into your neck.
Oh boy.
Okay. Can I still, you know, be squeezer and just go like, I made a mistake, help!
So that's a 5 damage with a piercing. So if you have armor, if you have one armor, then that's negated.
When do I ever have armor?
I don't know. and you are definitely stuck in this creature's embrace as it's trying to gnaw at your flesh and eat your inner stuff.
Not without dinner first, good sir. Oh god.
Polonius. Baldrick has courageously managed to get this dude off you. And it's clear to you that you sort of saw an arrow fly past your head into the chest of another ghoul that Hazel's got your back as well.
Mm-hmm.
But you see Baldrick in a deathly embrace, and you see two bloodthirsty ghouls charging and screaming at Hazel. What do you do?
Well, I imagine that in this situation that Hazel is probably better equipped to handle himself than Baldrick is. So I will see this occur, this sort of embrace occur between Baldrick and the ghoul. And I'll say, unhand him, fiend! And I'll sort of run up, and I want to use the, you know, get a little bit of speed on me and use my momentum to then sort of thrust my belly outwards, like knocking into them. Even if it hits Baldrick, I just want to sort of knock them both, like...
Okay.
Wait, even if it's hit Baldrick... No. What are we doing here?
I think
here?
This would also just be like a general hack and slash move.
The idea is that I'm trying to get this
general
thing
hack and slash?
Him.
Yeah, no, but that's fine. Then we'll reduce the damage that you do, and you if you succeed, you okay. your desired effect will.
Okay, cool. So that's a strength. Yeah, so that's minus one. Three. I rolled a three.
You rolled a three?
Yeah.
That's not good.
No, that's another XP, though, isn't it?
It's XP, yes, definitely. I think, let's see. Yeah, as you make a great show, it's like, unhand him, you fiend. The fiend sort of hears you coming, and it just sidesteps you completely. with Baldrick just dragging him back a bit. And you have this charge that ends up going nowhere. And I think you just end up charging into the other two guys that are rushing Hazel. You stumble and fall flat on your face.
Oh dear.
At which point these two guys are distracted and will try and take a bite out of this tasty, okay, flat body.
I have ended up protecting not the one I wanted, but you know, protection.
And you take 7 damage.
Oof, and make it mitigated by another one, yeah?
Because it pierces.
Oh, of course they don't.
Do you have? It depends on the armor rating of your.
It's just one.
Yeah, no, they pierce. So they imagine that there's these like ravenous zombies sort of munching on a corpse lying on the ground. That's the sort of general scene.
Yeah. Except
you're not dead yet.
Okay. Well, I mean, you say that.
Wait. What's your current HP at?
6 out of 19.
Yeah. Okay. Well, you're getting there.
Yeah.
Hazel, you see all of this happening. It's a clusterfuck, basically.
Pretty much like every time the three of us get together.
If you say run away, I will come back from the grave and haunt you.
That would be my first impulse, but... So the two ghouls that were moving towards Hazel are now distracted by Polonius' courageous
stumble.
Then I want to put an arrow in one of these two.
Okay.
Could you not target the one that you shot before? Is that one of these two, or is that a different
one?
That's
not one of these two.
No. Oh, no. Was that the one that's hugging?
I think that's Baldrick. The one that's bear hugging me.
Okay, cool.
No. The one...
Oh, was it not?
No, there were two guys. There's one with an arrow in its chest that is sort of getting back on its feet. And there's the other dude that was standing closest to Polonius that was, which was attacked by Baldrick, who then got grabbed.
Mm-hmm.
You tried to charge that guy. He sidestepped and you charged right into the other two.
Okay. All right. Okay.
So what about being being outnumbered made us think, yeah, this is a good idea.
Well, you weren't outnumbered at the start of the fight.
It's true. Just more came in.
So I guess that's a folly.
Yeah, definitely. Who do you want to? Which one do you want to shoot?
One of the two that are gnawing at Polonius.
Okay. Yeah.
I have a +2 on Dex, so that's a 9.
Yeah. You deal your damage, but you have to choose one of the three from the list.
Oh boy! Yeah, I think I'll have to take several shots, and I'll reduce my ammo by one.
Okay.
Hazel is just frantically shooting,
rapid firing stuff.
Yes. Yes.
There's probably several arrows hitting the mark, but not really doing damage. And that finally you have the final hit that does something, at least.
Yeah.
Please do many, many things. All of the things. Help, please.
Is the 1d4 still in effect, or is that only...
I think that's a 1d4 forward, so it's no longer in effect. No.
Okay. Pity.
So it's a flat d8.
That's 5 damage.
5 damage, okay. Let's pick that one. And Yeah, you hit it somewhere in the shoulder area, and it's sort of thrown off of Polonius, and it's turned back its attention to the most threatening member of the party, you. if that wasn't clear. Baldric, your life essence is being sucked away. What do you do?
And not in a fun way.
No, not that life essence.
What can I even do? Can I just try to squirm away? Just to try to, you know.
Sort of slither out of its grasp.
Pretty much, sort of try to like slide through and just, you know, scramble away.
I think that would be a dexterity check. I think nimbleness and sort of being slippery and fast. So that'd be a defy danger dexterity.
Dexterity, why not? That's only a plus zero. Okay.
Punch it.
What is this? What is it?
You get the mark XP, though.
Yay. I get to spend it in the afterlife.
God. You guys suck ass.
This is going to be a good first session.
It just keeps sort of draining you, right? And I don't think it does the initial damage that it, you know, it's the D8 damage for this one. It's just, it's not more, it's less. It's the slow, forceful drinking of your blood, basically. So I'll give you that.
I'll do the damsel in distress in the movie thing of like,
We'll give you this one. There we go. Yeah, you take 4 damage. As it keeps on draining your blood. Polonius, you are, I think, lying face first in the dirt with a ghoul hulking over you, trying to rip apart your chainmail and trying to get to the tasty bits.
Mm. It's true, I do have a lot of meat on me, in both senses. Let's think. I think what I'd do at this point is I would sort of, you know, I'm quite upset about the situation, so I'd say, Mon, damn it, if only I had my talisman. I'll say that quite loudly. I will try to... So it's on me, yes?
Yeah, it's sort of it's not sitting on top of you, but it's sort of like knelt next to you, like kneeling next to you and trying to claw at you.
Okay. Hold up. My life essences are being sucked away. Now there's somebody sitting on top of Polonius here. What are we doing here, Jaxus?
I don't know, you tell me.
I think it's just going to have to be a matter of endurance again. I'm just going to have to sort of, you know, curl up and hope that my my body fat helps deflect some of the blows, I guess.
Right. Then do the same roll.
I shall do that.
Manage to fend off this beast.
Oh, that's a 9.
Okay. I think you managed to sort of kick away the ghoul. Mm-hmm. But that's about it, really. You manage to sort of crawl away slightly, but you don't get mm-hmm. to. There's no time for you to do anything else. This has been, these creatures are quite strong. I think Hazel needs to be called in here as a fire support. Maybe you have an artillery gun somewhere you can use.
Actually, now that he says something about his talisman, hold on.
Probably so, as I'm rolling away, I'm like, "Oh, curse it! If I didn't have my talisman, it'd be so much better."
Wait, are you turning into Gandalf slowly?
Only I have my talisman with me.
I've been winded. Punched.
You shall not. If what you have is the talisman, Because you probably think it's a coin, right, Hazel?
Yeah, so...
So you could, what we could do is have you do a spout lore check to see if you realize that this is actually his talisman that you've stolen.
Let's do that.
That takes like a matter of seconds for you to figure that out, I think.
I would imagine, I would argue that it might be
10.
Right? You absolutely realize, wow. You've known all along, basically.
Seriously, what a boss.
Oh, wait, so that's why there's a chalice filled with wine on that coin.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. What do you do?
So...
Knowing this.
I take it out, and I sort of roll towards Polonius, and I want to give the coin in his hand.
Right.
Sort of a reverse sleight of hand.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think that's a dex-based defy danger.
I think there's no imminent danger here, because there's one dude sitting on top of Polonius, and the other one you sort of... You did draw his attention, because the damage you dealt was minor. Then it'd be a dexterity defy danger. So do you want to sort of roll in, give the thing, and then roll out?
A Dark Souls style.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Iframes.
It's called the panic spam roll, and hope you live.
So that's a 9, because I have a +2 on...
On your dexterity?
Akasha Gamer just going in with the host.
Yes.
And,
we were just we were talking about Dark Souls, and that's when the Akasha shows up.
Dark Souls. Yeah. Wild Akasha. you managed to roll in and fling the talisman into Polonius' hands. But right at that point, the other ghoul grabs your ankle, so you don't have time to roll out. I think that's the best outcome here. But Polonius, you now have your talisman in your hands.
Okay. What I want to do, right, is because I'm, there's a lot of chaos that's going on right now. Could I make a discern realities check or something along those lines to see whether or not I would recognize that it was Hazel that gave me the talisman? Like, I'm just trying to see if I noticed that.
You notice, because you know exactly where...
I was trying to angle for it immediately. Oh, if only I had my talisman, and I not notice, and then I look in my hand, I was like, praise be to Morn!
Well, in that case, it's totally up to you whether you've noticed.
Oh, okay. Okay, well, in that case, I think that's more interesting, so...
Alright, yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, yes, by the grace of Morn, you have your talisman.
So, by the grace, so I'm just like, oh, God, Morn be damned! And then he suddenly appears in my hand, and I'm like... Oh, Morn be praised, and I begin to sort of chant one of the canticles of Morn, and I will cast Turn Undead.
Okay. Turn Undead. When you hold your holy symbol aloft and call on your deity for protection, roll plus wisdom.
It sounds like, when you hold your holy symbol aloft.
That's probably what it sounds like. It's a hymn that I'm sort of singing here. And
turn the undead.
14 in total, double sixes.
Oh, absolutely amazing. On a 10 plus, you also, on a 7 plus, so long as you continue to pray and brandish your holy symbol, no undead may come within reach of you. On a 10 plus, you also momentarily daze intelligent undead and cause mindless undead to flee. Aggression breaks the effects and they are able to act as normal. Intelligent undead may still find ways to harry you from afar. They're clever like that. Well, these are not intelligent undead. These are definitely mindless undead trying to eat your flesh. They flee. So the two ghouls, one they're sort of next to you, and the other one clinging to Hazel, screech. You hear this loud as this holy light. Well, basically, no. But you tell us what it looks like.
Hmm. Yeah, no, I think there's a bit of holy light, but it's not like that's not like the only thing. The talisman glows in my hands, but you all of you who's like in this area, you can swear that you can hear coming drifting in over the wind like warriors, brave, singing songs of, you know, glory and victory, and you know, you hear the clang of steins and
spam.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Spam. That's what it is. Yeah. You know, it's like it looks like you sound you. You swear that you hear like a feast occurring just around the corner.
I'm hoping that it's gonna be those Franciscan monks like just...
Yes, it's exactly what that is. And yeah, they're all sort of, you know, getting away.
Nice. Yeah, so those two, they definitely retreat I think up to a range of about like a couple of meters, like 3 meters or something from you. But this area does not cover Baldrick, unfortunately.
Oh no!
Yes, so, son of a
Baldrick, what do you do? There's a leech in your neck.
So there's still that ghoul thing is sort of still biting away.
You definitely feel the warm holy glow of Polonius's talisman, and you also hear this angelic choir. Warriors.
Yep. Exactly.
You know, singing. There doesn't seem to be any effect to it. To you, it seems like, why the hell isn't anything happening here?
So, that guy is grabbing onto me. Can I sort of like just extend a hand, try and crawl towards them, going like, help! Son of a...
Yeah, you can power through with a strength check.
Probably
that's gonna go so well.
You could also do it with a constitution check, I think, by enduring.
Can I endure? Can I just?
Yeah, if enduring you, constitution. If you do it by enduring. Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, I'll endure because that is 12. That gives me +0. Yay! So good. Okay. Yeah, I'm gonna roll that endure. I'm just gonna try and sort of screech, just sort of crawl through.
Help me. Guys, not over yet.
Son of a... Come on! Rigged! Oh, rigged! Totally rigged!
You gain XP.
It's true.
I'm going to be the most leveled corpse around.
Oh, but this is...
It's alright, you do have a priest to perform your last rites.
What's your HP, current HP?
Actually, you didn't give me damage last time, so we kind of need
I
to
did.
Do that
it
as well.
I did, was 4 damage.
Was it 4 damage? No, yeah. I couldn't. So
I rolled a d4, I rolled 3.
Oh, we had 5 damage in the first, so then it's 4 in the second, which means I have 9 HP right now.
Oh, you'll be fine.
Double roll
you
death.
You 5 damage.
I'll be fine.
Yeah, as you know, you try to crawl out of the way, but you can't, you're too weak.
Okay. So I'm trying to crawl away, and I just sort of reach a hand out to them and go, tell them I was awesome!
I think Hazel, you've noticed a divine influence. How do you react? What do you do?
Yeah, so I am now... strengthened in my resolve to use the cleric as my meat shield because it works. But I see my buddy Baldrick being so apparently it doesn't work there. Yeah. I think I'll try to. Can I grab his hand that he stretched out and pull him towards us?
Definitely, if you do a defy danger strength check.
Okay, I'm just gonna say I know exactly how this is gonna.
Go,
you're gonna have a roll below 6, and my hand is just gonna pop off like. So
no, that's not how this works.
That was my artificial hand, you son of a bitch.
If you fail a roll, the danger is entirely on you. especially in case like this where it's pretty critical. But for instance, say you were walking on like some rickety floorboards as a party and one of you guys messes up, yeah, sure, everyone gets hurt by falling down. But in this case, no, that's not how it works. So no worries, okay, so you won't be losing your hand yet.
Yet. So it's a defy danger strength check.
Yeah, I think so, definitely. Okay. Good luck.
Luckily, I have a minus one in that. So.
Oh, that's gonna be good.
Hey.
Doesn't matter.
It's a seven.
Okay. I think.
Flipping the table.
Only a 7 and 9. You stumble, hesitate, or flinch. The GM will offer you a worse outcome, hard bargain, or ugly choice. I think I will give you an ugly choice. You can choose to live to sort of leave Baldrick there, or you can drag him towards you. But that means that you're also dragging this guy that's on top of it towards you, and he has definitely noticed you. And he will take a swipe. So you will be damaged.
Yeah. So normally Hazel would.
Oh wait, that reminds me. We're supposed to do health here, right?
Yes.
Oh, good point, actually.
No, I'll. Hazel will continue to pull Baldrick in. Because he is maybe overconfident in the abilities of Polonius to deal with these guys.
Right, cool. Take 3 damage, and it pierces 1 armor. As it sort of swipes at you and slang on top of Baldrick, and you're just dragging the two. I don't know how, because you're a halfling, and these are just human-sized figures. But I think I'm
very small, light, and svelte.
I think as it swipes you and it hits you in the chest and it sort of stumbles towards you, it enters Polonius's sphere of influence, basically, and it starts screeching immediately and runs back to the barn.
Oh God! It is Bloodborne.
Which leaves us with the ghoul that you shot and sort of stumbled back that I forgot about completely, but suddenly remembered. he also sort of retreats towards the barn, and they're trying to stay in a sort of circle around you guys, right? There's 4 ghouls, and I think that they're going to be like a pack of hungry hyenas or wolves or whatever. They're sort of trying to circle you and trying to sort of swipe at you, not hopefully not being hit by the divine power of Morn the Stoic.
As soon as I can, I'm just rolling, crawling, getting in just in the middle of that. I'm going to be hugging Polonius's leg, just literally like.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
I think the moment that you sort of clasp around my leg, I put my hand, like one hand still on the talisman that's glowing, and you still hear this music. I put my hand on you and say, "Fear not, my child. Oh, God watches over you."
Amazing.
I'm going to poop my pants.
Possibly yeah, so converting to my faith.
What do you do? As long as Polonius keeps chanting and praying, nothing's much is going to happen. But it's sort of a standoff, yeah. Right?
Yeah. So it doesn't say that I can. You know, it doesn't say I can't move.
Well,
okay. Yeah. So I think that at this point we were ill prepared and are currently still ill-equipped to deal with this threat. So I think that a strategic retreat would probably be the best option. And I would like to, you know, keeping Hazel and Baldrick close to me. Again, one hand reassuringly on Baldrick. And I'm continually saying, don't worry, Morn will see us through. I want to sort of keep it, you know, do the whole Frodo with the light of Erendil. It's a shield. Right, yeah. You know, like, get back, foul creatures. And I want to sort of slowly back away out of the gate and from where we came.
If we're doing that, if he has a hand on my head, then I will put an arm awkwardly around him in the most awkward spot I can find, just hugging close to him.
Wow.
Yeah, it's fine. I think my faith in Morn is so thoroughly, you know, what's the word, justified, at this point.
I think, you know, you can retreat. That's obviously a good option, but that doesn't mean that the ghouls aren't following. They will still sort of circle around you as you move out of the gate.
Does anyone have a strip of cloth or something? Something we can set on fire and shoot into that barn.
But they're not in the barn, right?
No, but of course I have a flask of oil that we can light and use as sort of Molotov cocktail.
Okay, so you asked that, do you, Baldrick?
Just literally ask.
Okay,
that.
In that case, I take my hand off of you and outstretch my arm and say, "Take my sleeve." It's just like cloth robes, so you have to tear it off. I've still got one hand on the talisman keeping them away, so you have to tear off my sleeve.
Yeah, you'll have to do the actions, yeah. Hazel, if you want, you can also sort of take pot shots at the guys, right? Using your bow and just shoot arrows at them. It's really up to you what you guys want to do. I wouldn't recommend getting close to them, though.
Yeah. I can continue shooting them and just sort of wear them down.
Yeah.
We could torch the place.
The thing is, you're right now you're out in the open, right?
I have a plan, right? If I, and I'm going to need your assistance in this, Jaxus. Let's see. I'm trying to think. You can decide what role this would be. I want to sort of use my talisman to herd them, you know, into the barn. Right. And maybe stand at the door and then set the thing on fire.
So you're literally like a sheepdog just going to the left, going to the right, and sort of like...
this is what I'm thinking, you know, if that's possible. That's kind of what
I think you don't need to roll for that. You've rolled an excellent turn undead. And you are still brandishing your talisman, praying away. I think with some clever maneuvering, you'd be able to manage to hurt them into the barn. Definitely, yes.
Okay,
let's have this sort of scene where Hazel and Baldur desperately try to cling around Polonius, try to stick as close to him as possible, and whereas Polonius is just trying to get these ghouls sort of back into the barn. That works. I think you know, you can sort of stand in the opening, the barn opening with your talisman there, and they're sort of trying to grab at you, but, you know.
As I'm, you know, out of the door and they're sort of trapped in this, I'll turn to Hazel and say, "Let it be done."
Let it be done. So, is there anything that's particularly burnable in the... barn.
Yes.
Hay.
Yes. There's hay and there's like grain and
there's lovely flammable zombies.
If you have like a flask of oil, and that's not a problem at all.
Okay. Yeah. Sure. I will. Expand one of my adventuring gear, and throw a burning flask of oil onto the hay.
So what do you pull out of the adventuring gear?
A flask of oil.
Okay, yeah. Okay. So yeah, mark one use and sure. Roll a volley.
A volley. Okay.
You shoot me in the back with a flaming arrow.
No, you're tossing the oil flask, right? And
That's a 10.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Describe to me what this looks like and what happens next.
Yeah. Okay. So I have this flask that I light, or with a wick that I light, and I throw it into the barn, and it hits. A wooden pillar, a wooden support of the hayloft, or of the roof, and the burning oil falls on a pile of hay that's under that roof support, and it's dry, it's dried out, so it catches flame immediately, and the roof support sort of catches flame as well, and within a minute the roof is on fire, and from there the fire spreads to the whole
roof. The roof is on fire.
Exactly.
Yeah. And I'd like to think that...
deduct one of your points of XP, please, Baldrick, for that one.
Come on.
Are the ghouls going up in this? Like, they're on fire. Yes. Now.
Yeah, okay. They are. I think
they're burning to death. Yeah,
they're burning to death. Yeah, there's no danger here from those guys.
Okay. In that case, you know, I still have my talisman out, just making sure they can't. Maybe they're trying to claw. You know, they're doing the whole. I can't say Half-Life references because you've still got to play that. But yeah, they're still holding out my talisman, making sure they don't get out. And maybe one crawls out of the inferno, maybe trying to... And I want to sort of shove the talisman in its face, maybe...
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Ooh, time for a Wilhelm stream.
Yeah,
I want to sort of, like, you know... The chant that I'm still... like saying I want to reinvigorate, so I, you know, speak in a louder voice, and I just want to force it into the mud as the life slowly ebbs away from it.
Yeah, and which would count as an offering to your god, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to stand behind him and go, yeah, take that.
Yes. And then as soon as, you know, they're not moving anymore, I will, sort of recite a final chapter in this tale that I've been telling, this chant, and then lower the talisman, the light goes out, the singing and the merrymaking that you swear you can hear goes away. And then I sigh.
Nice. Yeah, I think, you know, sweet, as you, you're sort of standing there with I'm probably near the well now or something, that the barn burning in the background, and you hear the screams of the ghouls inside. As they burn to a crisp. Mm-hmm. I think this would be a good place to end it for tonight.
Sorry, one more thing. We're near the well, yeah?
Yes.
Yeah. Is there water in the well that's within reach? It's not like dried up.
If you're going to turn it to wine, that's...
Well, why don't you roll a discern realities for
me? Okay. Using what extra?
Wisdom.
So that's plus 2 for me. Boom, that's a 10 total.
All right, so you get to ask 3 questions from the...
Okay, is there water in the well?
From the list.
Oh, damn it, I keep forgetting that. What is useful or valuable to me?
Yeah, there's a bucket there attached to a rope that you can lower down.
Okay. I suppose, what should I be on the lookout for? Don't want any snakes in the water or anything.
As you sort of peer down the well, you notice that there's all sorts of smears of blood lining the inside of the stone, right? Look closer, and there's even some broken fingernails stuck in the stone, right?
Oh dear.
Nasty.
So then last one will obviously be, what happened here recently?
I think little Timmy fell down the well. I think little Joanna as well in the well.
Uh-huh.
And little Robbie.
Uh-huh.
And maybe Mother Josephine and Father Bernard.
All of these NPCs.
You notice that there's no water in the well.
So maybe I sort of go, I sigh a bit and I go, it's like, it's okay, I can, and, you know, thinking that I can, like, get some water and maybe bless it or something along those lines, and I peer inside and I just go, oh. Roll credits.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Sweet. Okay. That was amazing. Before we sort of actually finish things, we get to do the end of session things.
Mm-hmm.
And the text literally says, when you reach the end of a session, choose one of your bonds that you feel is resolved, completely explored, no longer relevant or otherwise. Ask the player of the character you have the bond with if they agree. If they do, you mark XP and write a new bond with whoever you wish. Hazel, do you feel that there's a bond that has been fully exhausted? That's no longer
Well, one of my bonds is I stole something from Polonius. I think we definitely resolved that.
Yeah, nice. Does Polonius feel the same?
Well, the issue was is that as far as Polonius was concerned, the talisman actually didn't come from you. Polonius had no idea. I don't know if that precludes whether or not he gets XP.
No, that's fine. If you agree that this bond
I definitely have my talisman back. As far as Polonius thinks that it was by the grace of Morn, but
yeah, I think definitely you can mark off this bond, gain one XP, and then you can write a new one with
okay.
Whomever you want. You could even write a bond with Morn the Stoic, for instance. And you don't need to fill in like the preset one, so you can just make up one yourself.
Okay.
You don't necessarily have to do that right now, because I assume, Paolo, that we're going to be playing some more?
I think so, yeah. And then maybe next time, Tracy will be able to join us as well.
Totally up to, yeah.
Yeah, so I think we can definitely have another player in here. Four players absolutely fine.
If we're gonna do it again next weekend, I'd be totally up for that, because at that point I will have finished my academic year, so I'm a free bird.
We'll have to plan. I don't know what the schedule looks like for us, but we'll talk about that later. But yep, then sure. Then just think of a bond and write one, and then we'll discuss that next time we play. Baldrick, do you have a bond that you feel is going to be resolved?
I don't think so at all. I mean, butt of my jokes, didn't really go that much into it. Writing a ballad, not really. Polonius doesn't trust me. That's fair enough. But still, no. I think we've really done anything.
Do some more stuff with that on a roleplay level.
Yeah.
And Polonius. What about you?
Baldrick, are you now touting the faith of Morn the Stoic as your own?
No, not really. No, I just nearly died.
Exactly, and then I saved you. The power of Morn was the only thing that...
Maybe the seed has been planted.
Yeah, seed has been planted.
No, I nearly died. You let me die. You saved everyone but me. I had to crawl there. So
I think conversion requires a bit more than a simple display.
Other than that, my two other ones, which are Baldrick has insulted my deity, I do not trust them. I don't think, we haven't really gone into that at all. Maybe next time when I ask him, it's like, what do you think about Morn now? And then Hazel is a good and faithful person. I trust them implicitly. I mean, as far as I was concerned, the talisman was delivered to me by Morn. And
I think until we get into a situation where either Hazel proves definitely that he is trustworthy, then you can resolve it. Or if he proves that he is not trustworthy at all, then it's also resolved.
I've not done that bit of role playing.
So now look at your alignment. Hazel, what's your alignment?
My alignment is neutral.
Yes.
And the description is avoid detection or infiltrate a location.
Okay. Do you feel that has been the case?
No, we completely blundered into this and then all hell broke loose.
Okay, so no XP for you for that. Baldrick.
Well, so I'm neutral. I need to avoid a conflict or defuse a tense situation. Well, I mean, there wasn't really a tense situation I could defuse. I don't think I kind of avoided conflict. I mean, I went in there, so...
Yeah, no, I think you even encouraged conflict by spurring on Hazel to do more damage.
I personally avoided conflict.
I don't think it applies here. Polonius.
Endanger yourself, follow... I'm lawful, by the way, and it says endanger yourself following the precepts of your church or God. Now, I'm not sure that... I don't think Morn really has very much concerning what to do should you face undead, but I mean, I definitely used the power of Morn to defeat...
I think in a very literal sense, you offered yourself in defense of Baldrick. You tried to charge at a guy...
That's also true, yeah.
And then got eaten.
Okay, fair enough.
Maybe I'd award an XP for that one.
Cool, awesome.
And then as a group, there's these three questions that we need to answer Did we learn something new and important about this world that we're in?
Not really.
I mean, I learned that this house used to have a bunch of people in it, and they've all been chucked down a well.
Exactly. And there's been undead.
Is that new and important about the world?
Well, you don't think it's important that there's an infestation of undead?
I don't know if there's an infestation. Near a town?
It sounded pretty infesty to me. There was a lot of them.
You haven't explored the rest of the house yet.
Well, it's going to burn down in a minute.
Well, the barn isn't connected to the house itself.
Oh,
so
okay. All
right. You haven't gone down the well, so you have no idea what's going on, really.
I don't think I could fit.
I think you did learn something new and important.
Yeah, I think so too.
Definitely, I think it's definitely important to the town where you sort of been banished from that there's these undead roaming the countryside. Everyone mark 1 XP for that one. So did we overcome a notable monster or enemy? Absolutely not.
What?
No.
Wait, that's not those notable.
Yeah, but ghouls are not notable. I think notable in Dungeon World means like a named NPC, for instance. Like there's this Ruzak the Necromancer, I don't know, or Billy the Great, or stuff like that, or like
Billy the Great
killing a random lich that I made up, you know, like a really powerful creature. Yes, definitely.
So Baldric got his ass handed to him by, you know, complete mobs.
Basically, yes. I'm not saying that they're not.
This is a common occurrence.
This is this is a world, or basically a game where, much like Dark Souls, everything can kill you. Mm-hmm. Because if you make a mistake, you get damaged. If you completely roll like a 6-, then you get extra damage and you put yourself in a spot where you get more damage. So the only way of avoiding that is by rolling 10+, basically, on attacks, which is hard to do. So yeah, ghouls by themselves, not that hard. Like multiple ones, harder, but not notable, unfortunately for you guys. But we'll get to that.
Barn count as a notable enemy?
No. Did we loot a memorable treasure? No, we didn't.
I mean, there was an eye.
We had an eyeball.
I would remember that.
So what are you going to do with an eyeball then?
I take it back to the town and use it as evidence. I say, oh, this is, you know, maybe one of the people, maybe one of the people in town knows.
Then you could use that.
There's the color of the eyes of one of them, and just like
I'd be willing to give you a +1 on a parlay check if you go back to town with the eye. But I'm not gonna give you extra.
I don't think. Have you seen this boy? Works with just an eyeball.
But this is quite common for a first session, by the way. Mm-hmm. I think Paolo, we had this when we did the thing with the tower and the
I think
we had wolves there or something. You know, it was a wicked fight, but not notable, and there was not much treasure to be had there. Mm-hmm. But we'll get there. So basically, what happens now is I have more than enough information to sort of build a campaign or adventure for you guys with what we did. Mm-hmm. And then in that adventure or in that campaign, I'll leave sort of like blank spots that we can fill in together. So like next time we'll be a bit more structured because right now it's been all improvised. And then next time at least there'll be more like a clearer goal, basically. Mm-hmm. Cool. So yeah, I had a lot of fun. Thank you very much for playing.
As did I.
I'll leave it
thank
to
you for running
to,
it.
Yes.
To Byronic to close it off.
Close up officially. Close up. Absolutely.
Professional stream.
Super professional. Starting late, not having loads of things work.
So
switching. Yeah, we're just super professional. No. Thank you very much, Jax. I'm very happy that you do the DMing, and I'm very much hoping that we get to do this more often. And as well, next time, hopefully with Tracy as well, so we get a good 4-person group in here. Fubbub, thank you very much for logging in here at the last moment, last minute thing.
Thank you for having me.
Well, absolutely. It was a lot of fun, I think. And Hothar, I think you kind of did most of the work here today.
I did nothing. It was all the power of Morn.
Yeah, still not getting converted. Sorry.
I'll get you. I'll get it.
So thank you everyone for watching as well. Akashe, Sir Koala for the host as well, and Jexus obviously. That was very cool. I'm hoping that we'll see when we do this again. You know, provisionally next week. You know, next weekend somewhere. We'll have to get in touch via Twitter, I'm assuming. For now,
works for me.
Yeah, perfect. For now, thank you so much for watching, for joining in chat. Thank you guys for playing. I'm hoping to see you next time. See you guys.
Bye. Thanks, guys.